Good morning, everyone. I'm going to invite you to stand to your feet and sing with us this morning.
Really live like Jesus was all we needed. Just imagine how much easier life would be in some senses. I realize it would be struggle or a challenge in some other ways, but if we really just were content and realized that Jesus is all we need, and that's why we're here, is to be reminded of that as we sing about it, as we listen to God's word being taught. But that's just something that I hope we walk away with today, is really saying it's okay. Jesus really is all that we need. And if you're like me, when you come, some of you are just kind of on autopilot, right? You drove, you get up at the same time, you probably had the same morning breakfast, you drove the same way, you might even be sitting in the same seat. And before I realized that, I wanted to change seats, but I want you to like me this morning, so I'm not going to do that. But what I would like to do is just for a moment pause and allow you and God just to kind of say, you know, everything that I'm worried about, everything that's got my focus, it's not God, I'm just going to set it down. So let's just take a moment quietly to kind of do that, and then I'll pray at close that time. Father, I thank you for all that are here and all that are tuning in. And Lord, I realize that we can kind of just go through the motions. In a way, habits are really helpful to us in many different ways, that we can do things habitually that we don't have to think about, that just makes our lives easier. But Lord, when it comes to our relationship with you, when it comes to worship, that just doesn't hold true. And I pray this morning that we truly are just going to be hyper-focused on you, the teaching of your word, the songs that we sing to express our thanks and our praise, and just to let you know that we think you are great and you are good. And I pray you'll bless this time of worship and all who participate in it. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. One other thing, when we take the offering in a little bit, last week we prayed for four different things that are going on that were really concerning. One of them was Haitian relief and all that's going on in Haiti. And thank you for willing to give towards just relieving their struggle in some way. We're going through Samaritan's Purse, and we're going to do that again this week. So if you want, there's the envelopes in the back. You can just indicate what the amount that you want to go towards that, and then we'll get that to the right place. Okay, so thank you.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your come to pass. My heart Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, and this is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. With all that I am, I will praise you, maker of heaven and earth. And I lift my hands in surrender, Jesus, my God. As long as I live, I will worship. Your love is better than life. Your favor will last for a lifetime, Jesus, my God. You are my God, and oh, the wonder of your great love. And Lord, your presence is more than enough. And I will
from age to age.
Let's pray. Father, we are just so incredibly grateful for this place to gather together to worship you as a community. And I just pray for each and every single person that's in here this morning. No matter what we walked in here with this morning, whether it's a hurt, a pain, anxiety, a fear, a frustration, I pray this morning that we would lay that down at your feet, that you would heal us, that you would move in us, and that you would open up our hearts and our eyes and our ears and our minds to your word this morning. We pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You can have a seat.
Good morning. It's Christy Rayburn. I am Interim Director of Spiritual Growth here at High Point, and I have got some great stuff to share with you. First of all, mark your calendars for Sunday, September 19th, because it is Merge. Okay, some of you are saying, what on earth is Merge? I'm so glad you asked. It's this great time that you gather with the leaders and we give you a little glimpse into the life of the High Point family, how we operate, and you can ask questions and meet the different leaders, and oh yes, there's pizza. So make sure you sign up online or the back of the Connect card. The next thing I want to tell you about is on the same day, September 19th, and this is huge. That's why I'm the one talking to you about it. We are kicking off small groups. Now, small groups is where we no longer sit in pews on a Sunday, but we are gathering in circles in people's homes, and it's a safe place where we get to know God together, and you can even ask questions. You know how many times you've wanted to interrupt Kevin and kind of go, whoa, I've got a question, or explain that. Well, small groups are the safe place where we get to not only just share life together, but we get to explore all the questions that we honestly have. So we'll be signing up on the 19th. The last thing, okay, is kind of just too incredibly exciting. We've been waiting over a year to be able to do this. Yes, it is High Point Open House. We are opening up this incredible, miraculous building that God gave us and this property to our entire community. We're saying, we want you guys to come check us out, see what we're all about. So Saturday, October 2nd, we're doing that. Well, as High Point says, all hands are needed on deck. Yes, so not only is it our responsibility to be reaching out and inviting people, but we need to be the ones serving and making it happen. So please go to the website, go online on the app and sign up, or you can do that on your forms that are sitting on the chairs if you're here in person. Well, that's all the stuff I need to tell you, but Ethiopia actually has something they want to tell you because they are so thankful for how generous the hearts of High Point are.
No? Hey, there we go. Not too bad. My son's going to hear about that. No, it's... Well, thank you for being here this morning. We are going to continue our study of Matthew, but before we do that, I'd like us to take a few minutes for some immediate prayer on three particular needs, certainly by far, not the only ones, but three particularly right now, and that is Afghanistan, Hurricane Ida, which is approaching the Gulf Coast, and then also the ongoing humanitarian crisis in Haiti, as Kevin mentioned. So please join me in prayer. Lord, we know you are sovereign. We know you are almighty. We know nothing happens except by your decree. And we know this is a world that is damaged and broken by sin. And we know it's a place where a lot of terrible things happen. And we just thank you that you love all people. And there is a plan. And in our finite little minds here on earth, we have trouble seeing it, but we trust in you, and we know you are here, and you are active and present in all lives. But Lord, particularly today, we think of Afghanistan. We think of the families of our American soldiers who voluntarily put themselves in harm's way to help others and have lost their lives and have so hurt and disrupted and damaged the lives of loved ones. And we thank you, Lord, for their service, but also our hearts break for what their families are dealing with. And also, Lord, for the Afghan people. This is not a new thing. This is really centuries of a place where people have lived constantly under violence and oppression. And right now, Lord, they've got it coming from more than one direction. And Lord, no matter if they're Christ followers or not, it's pain. And we know that your heart breaks for the pain and suffering. And we ask, Lord, especially for the protection of our Afghan brothers and sisters who still, I know, are persevering in making sure Jesus Christ is known. And we thank you and ask you for their continued protection and their continued assurance of your guidance. And finally, for Haiti, another place where it seems like it is consistently a humanitarian crisis. And we've seen now in the last few years, half a million people killed by earthquakes and ongoing poverty and political unrest. And Lord, I thank you so much for the people who call you Lord, who are in Haiti doing the work that you would have them do to alleviate these people's plights. And number one, serving the immediate physical needs, but number two, being there to offer, as we saw in the video, the true bread of life. And then finally, for the Gulf Coast, Lord, we live in a place that you've blessed with material means to prepare as best we can for natural disasters. I thank you for that, the communication, the ability for people to move and get out of harm's way. But we know that if this predicted hurricane is as strong and hits as hard as it is, there will be a lot of upheaval and suffering in that area. And so, Lord, we particularly ask for us to be willing to serve however that may be needed, whether it's financially or whether even some of us might be called to go immediately and help, as has been done in the past with people from High Point, especially Hurricane Harvey. Think about that. What a great outpouring. So, Lord, we know that when we look back and we see your glorious plan, we'll know why everything fit in. And so right now, we just ask that you would continue to fill us with your Holy Spirit, that our hearts would break for those whose hearts are breaking and are in dire situations, but that we would have the hope and the assurance that you are in control and that all things will work for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this morning we're going to continue with Matthew in chapter 17. Last week, Kevin taught on the transfiguration, and so I would encourage you, if you were not here, weren't able to hear it, that you go back and listen to it. And so we'll continue now in Matthew chapter 17, and we're going to be on verse 14. So this morning we'll be reading from verses 14 through 21. When they reached the crowd, a man approached and knelt down before him. Lord, he said, have mercy on my son because he has seizures and suffers terribly. He often falls into the fire and often into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they couldn't heal him. Jesus replied, you unbelieving and perverse generation, how long will I be with you? How long must I put up with you? Bring him here to me. Then Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of him, and from that moment the boy was healed. Then the disciples approached Jesus privately and said, why couldn't we drive it out? Because of your little faith, he told them. For truly I tell you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will tell this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. Thank you, Lord, for your word. So context here, and by the way, this is also related in Mark and Luke, and as is wonderful with the Bible, three perspectives on the exact same event, and so adds a little bit different perspective or different angle from each one, and it adds to the whole thing. So what I would encourage you to go back and read those as well to parallel this. So what we see in the context here is Jesus has come down from the Mount of Transfiguration, and this is the next day. And so this man approaches the disciples and asks for healing. They're not able to do it. Jesus then heals. The disciples ask, how could you do that? Why couldn't we do it? He tells them why. And then we move on. Simple story, but packed with a lot. Now, the very first thing we see here is the challenge to us. We're going to put this up front today. Instead of at the end, we're going to put it up front. And I'm going to ask you this. Take today's challenge. Where do you truly put your faith? And if you are a person who calls yourself a Christian, a Christ follower, I'm going to ask you right now to set aside the answer to this. Because it's too easy for those of us who call Jesus Lord and Savior to immediately say, I put it in Jesus. And then for the next few minutes, kind of not much is going to happen. I'm going to ask you to set that to the side. I'm going to ask you to seriously consider it as we walk through this. Where do you truly put your faith? Now, the man there obviously has faith, or else he wouldn't have done what he did. It's kind of interesting because what we see here is a very clear example of desperation. And a real key to exactly what that means, because true faith in Jesus is born out in despair. True faith is born in despair. Now, at first, you might say, well, of course, the man was desperate. His son had all these problems, and he was trying to find a cure, but that's actually not really the biblical truth. The truth is this. If you call yourself a Christ follower, to paraphrase R.C. Sproul, we who were created from the dirt by the most holy God, we have absolutely no reason to be able to approach him. Zero. Nothing we could do can allow us to approach him. That's despair. That's why those of us who call Christ Lord and Savior came to him, because he reached to us. He reached down to us. We didn't reach to him. He reached to us, and then we grabbed hold because of despair. And I know people are sitting there saying, yeah, and you're thinking a particular time and a particular place on what that despair was. But that's for everybody, because there is no other option out of that despair except for hell. But Jesus allows us an option out of that. Now, another man exhibited despair, and that was David. A little different. Psalm 6, if you'd like to turn to that. Psalm 6 is an example of what we just talked about. David says, Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger. Do not discipline me in your wrath. Be gracious to me, Lord, for I'm weak. Heal me, Lord, for my bones are shaking. My whole being is shaken with terror. And you, Lord, how long? Turn, Lord. Rescue me. Save me because of your faithful love. For there is no remembrance of you in death. Who can thank you in Sheol? I am weary from my groaning. With my tears I dampen my bed and drench my couch every night. My eyes are swollen from grief. They grow old because of all my enemies. Three stanzas of despair right there. Three stanzas of despair. However, the faith is right here. Depart from me, all evildoers, for the Lord has heard the sound of my weeping. The Lord has heard my plea for help. The Lord accepts my prayer. All my enemies will be ashamed and shake with terror. They will turn back and suddenly be disgraced. So we see there the example of David showing that despair, but also exhibiting that absolute faith in the Lord and what he will accomplish. Second point is that true faith is abundantly clear in times of trouble and turmoil. True faith is abundantly clear in times of trouble and turmoil. Now, let's go back to this man who brought his son. Remember, he went to the disciples first. And if you're thinking, why the disciples? That's because he had to have known what they were able to do. And why that happened is what we studied back in March in chapter 10. I remember it because I gave the message, sorry. But if you don't remember it, don't feel bad. Hopefully this will rekindle your thoughts. What happens is Jesus commissions his disciples, these guys who will become officially the apostles, to go out into Israel. And he gives them the power to heal. But specifically this, he gives them the power to cast out demons. So that is known, that Jesus' disciples, this group of 12, can cast out demons. So he is showing faith when he comes to it. Okay, it's abundantly clear. He is showing his faith. Now, obviously, that doesn't happen. So he doesn't pause. He goes straight to Jesus. He goes down to his knees. He knows who he's speaking to, and out of faith asks the exact same thing. It's abundantly clear how he reacted. Now, what about us? What about us in our current world that we live in? Is it abundantly clear? We are definitely in a time of trouble and turmoil, no doubt about it. Now, you've heard me speak enough, those of you who've been here, that as a student of history, I'm very cautious on saying these are the worst times, you know, that we've ever seen. And, you know, I've given the example, I'll give it again. I was a kid, I remember 1968, but I remember G.I. Joes. You know, that's my perspective. However, 1968 was a pretty lousy year. Started the year with the Tet Offensive in Vietnam. We were told that the light is at the end of the tunnel in the war in Vietnam, and it all of a sudden seemed like it turned completely the other way. We have a president who was essentially hounded out of office. Lyndon Johnson announced he would not be running for president again, suddenly and without any warning. In April, Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. 2 months later, Bobby Kennedy was assassinated. 2 months later, we have the Democratic Convention in Chicago, where it's just massive violence in the streets. It was not a good year, to say the least. And we've got plenty of those bad years in the past. I heard a guy, a speaker this week, and he said, we might want to be careful about talking how bad we have it as Christians right now, because we might want to ask the first century Christians how bad it was. It was terrible for them in so many ways. Now, that doesn't minimize in any way the personal, what was happening to somebody personally. That is in no way talking about it. I'm talking about us as a collective group, talking about how difficult it is for us as Christians living in America and with what we're dealing with. I didn't know what was gonna be on the plugs this morning, and I came in and there's Ethiopia, and I see this little hut, and I see numbers up there of 128 Muslims converted to faith in Jesus Christ. And I think, okay, High Point, if we were told one day, High Point Church is that little hut right here in Graham, that's all we're going to have, come on and do church, how would we respond? I don't know that we would do real well, at least initially. What? How can you function? So we have to have perspective. I mean, here are people who are literally in an area that has starvation, and yet with the contributions of the people following Jesus and with their conviction and their faith that his word will prevail, we're seeing people come to Christ in numbers that if that happened here, 128 people who just declared Jesus as their Lord and Savior the first time, people would say, there's a revival going on there. I'm not joking. They would. That's what they would call it. So let's be careful about talking about how bad things are. But even more importantly, and this is what's concerning to me and troubling, is how we're talking, especially to each other. How are we handling this? Okay, and there's more than one thing. We know that is currently a difficulty. How are we handling that? How are we speaking to each other when it comes to this? What is the way we are relating? Well, there's some examples of how to relate to times of turmoil and trouble in terms of following the Lord. In June, we learned about Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and how they reacted to it. And if you don't remember, that's okay. I do, because I gave the message. And what we saw, and we're not going to go into the whole review of that, but what we saw is these guys, remember, they were literally uprooted and planted into a pagan society. They had to learn the language. They ended up working for the government and being effective. And Scripture says nothing about it, but I would have to think, knowing human nature, that they were criticized by their fellow Jews for doing that, questioning their faith. Maybe especially the ones who were still back, the remnant that God had permitted to be left behind. But what we'll focus on real quickly in our review is how they reacted to trouble and turmoil. How did they react to it? Well, remember, when those times came, they towed the line on what they knew was the Lord's will. And they said, they can't go past that line. But how they reacted to the people there is the crucial thing. No condemnation. They didn't say, you dirty pagan king, I'm not following you. It wasn't angry denunciations. In fact, there was no anger at all. When Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego were about to be thrown in the furnace, they said, they addressed the king with respect and said, basically, you have to do what you need to do, but we trust the Lord. Even if we die, we trust in him completely. Our faith is completely in him. And then there's another guy. He is amazing. His name is Stephen, and I would encourage you to turn to Acts chapter 7. Chapter 7. I'll talk a little bit about him. Go back and read 6 and 7, Acts 6 and 7. And so Stephen, real quick background on Stephen. Stephen is kind of the second tier to the apostles. The Hellenistic Jews, in other words, people who became Christians, or Hellenistic Christians, excuse me, who became Christians but were Gentiles, they were not Jews, had a complaint. And they said, you're taking care of all the Jewish Christian widows, but not the ones from the Hellenistic Christian widows. And the apostles looked at it, and they agreed, and they said, okay. And they appointed a group of men to oversee this. Philip was one of them. Amazing story. Follow Philip's ride through there. But Stephen was another one. Stephen also had another gift, and that was he absolutely would speak the truth to authority. And he was hauled before the Sanhedrin. And as you read through chapter 7, It is an amazing discourse. And they do not know how to react to him. In fact, all they can do to react to him is yell at him and make spurious claims to him. So let's go to chapter 6, verse 54, and see how Stephen reacted. When they heard these things, they were enraged and gnashed their teeth at him. Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven. He saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. He said, "Look, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." They yelled at the top of their voices, covered their ears, and together rushed against him. You realize that's like what we think of little kids, you know, covering your, I'm not listening, blah, 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 blah. That's literally what they were doing. They dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their garments at the feet of a young man named Saul, and we know who he is. While they were stoning Stephen, he called out, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." He knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." And after saying this, he died. So the trouble and turmoil Stephen faced was that people literally dragged him out to kill him with rocks. And his reaction is, "Lord, do not hold this against them." No condemnation. I mean, these are people who are, in essence, enemies of his. And that's how he reacts. And yet, sadly, today, in the big C church, as we say, that means, you know, Christianity, but also, sadly, probably here, we've got people talking to each other as if they're enemies. And if we're not talking that way, there's probably a lot of thinking that way because of perhaps a disagreement. John records Jesus. And Jesus says in chapter 13, verse 34, "I give you a new command. Love one another just as I have loved you. You are also to love one another." Let's stop there for a second. Just as he loved us, we are to love one another. And we talked about how these guys reacted to the enemies. There was a purpose there. That's how they reacted to the enemies. We're to love one another as Jesus loved us. Remember, we who were made of dirt by literally Jesus himself, and then he died for us after we had absolutely sinned against the Holy God. And he loves us that much. And yet, we talk to people in a way that is so less than loving over a disagreement? It's not there. It's not there. I'm reading it. And then he says, "By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." Okay, everyone will know you're my disciples. Is those people out there? October 2nd. Open house. We're saying, people of Graham and the greater community, come on in, check out High Point. Hey, we have a message for you in a place. And I would expect they would come in, and none of them would think, "Oh, everybody here agrees exactly on everything." I wouldn't expect that, but I would think they would expect everybody here would care and love each other. You know, the great American troubadour, Don McLean, had a line, "I saw Satan laughing with delight." But we sang this morning, Satan is vanquished and Jesus is king. And he has called us to love each other as he loves us. So that those people out there, and I'm saying that just as a descriptor, will know we are truly his disciples, and they'll say, this is a place where I can encounter God. These are people who are serious. Now, in case we need a reminder, and some of you have memorized this, 1 Corinthians chapter 13 gives us some specifics on what it means to love one another. Verse 4, love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy, is not boastful, is not arrogant, is not rude, is not self-seeking, is not irritable, and does not keep a record of wrongs. Love finds no joy in unrighteousness, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. And by the way, I looked, there is no clause in there that says, unless you disagree with somebody in the church. It's binding, folks. It is binding on us. There have always and there will always be disagreements. But we are called to love each other as Christ loved us and continues to love us. Finally, true faith is seen in our reliance on prayer. If you read the account in Mark chapter 9, the very last thing Jesus says in relation to this is he says, this can only be done by prayer. It can only be done by prayer. And he's speaking to the work of the Holy Spirit through people. You may or may not be familiar with a fellow named Paul Washer. He's a preacher. He's no holds barred preacher. And I heard him say once something to this effect. He said, you know, we complain about Engel versus Vitale, 1962. And if you're not familiar with that, that's the Supreme Court case that said that there could not be organized prayer in public schools. And I would agree, I think things would run smoothly, more smoothly in public schools if we started with prayer each day. Okay, but that's not the point he was making. He says we are constantly harping on that as the reason there's so many problems when, in effect, we have taken prayer out of our own churches. The amount of prayer in churches. Those of you who grew up in church, remember one night a week, Tuesday night, whatever it may be, Wednesday night, there was prayer meeting, right? That's what they called it, prayer meeting. And people went to prayer meeting. And our leadership over the years has tried to establish prayer meeting or the equivalent. Nobody shows. Now, if you think I'm pointing, yeah, I'm going to point right here. Not absolutely, but yeah. I mean, I'm as big a problem as anybody else when it comes to that. We have prayer gatherings. People don't go because, yeah, don't feel like it. But Jesus makes it clear. To make these things happen, it is vital that we are in prayer, that prayer is important to us. Now, this week, longer than this week, but especially this week as I've been working on this and focusing, you know, I didn't just get a dagger to the heart in this. It was like a samurai sword. Okay, don't think that I'm just up here telling you what's what. The Lord told me flat out, okay, you are part of that problem right there. With that in mind, we're going to finish in prayer today. And we're going to finish actually in specific prayer. We're going to pray for our pastor. And more importantly, we're going to pray for our pastor and his wife. Because Nancy has to experience everything Kevin does. And she's not directly involved in things but she has to experience it. And folks, here's what I would like. I would like for my pastor to be able to know that he's got the sufficient amount of time each week to prepare for the single most important thing he does for us as a church each week, and that is preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want him to know that he's got that time. I want him to have time to minister to people and really work what he's called to do, and that is to be that pastor that the Lord he's given us, the sheep, you know, the leader. And I want him to be able to go home and say to Nancy, I'm really tired, but it was a fulfilling day. It wasn't easy, but it was fulfilling. This is what I was called to do. I want Nancy to be able to have some rest and assurance that her husband's not getting pounded from all sides. I'm serious. It's time. We're going to pray for them. I'm going to ask them to come up front. I'm going to ask all of you to stand with us. If you would like to come up front and pray with them, you are welcome. You can pray just as well from there, but I'm going to invite you, if you'd like to come up front. So let's go to that time of prayer. Kevin and Nancy, please come up. And if you'd like to join them, you know you're welcome. Lord, this morning we give you thanks and praise that you brought Kevin and Nancy here by faith out of what was a comfortable position of life with family into a place where initially they knew no one. By faith, knowing that you had a call in their lives. And Lord, quite frankly, I'm amazed that for 20 years they've put up with us like they have. But each Sunday, Kevin comes out and tells us how much he loves being our pastor. Each Sunday, Nancy is going out of her way to work with our littlest ones and to give everybody a word of encouragement. And all during the week, they give of themselves to others so that you will be glorified. Lord, forgive us when we have not been supportive. Wash us clean of our sin. Lord, when Moses sent out his people to battle, he said he'd hold up his staff. And as his arms were raised, Joshua was able to lead the Israelites in victory. But as his arms got tired and they came down, the battle turned. But Aaron and Hur came up next to Moses and held up his hands, and the battle went to the Lord's army. Lord, let us in this way make a new commitment to hold Kevin and Nancy up and support them. Lord, we've taken way too much from them and given way too little back. But Lord, we thank you that you stir us and you move our hearts, and the Holy Spirit can refresh us and give us new vision, and that we as a family, a church will be committed that from this point on, we're going to love each other as you love us. And the world will see we're your disciples. And then we'll be able to look back and say, okay, Lord, we've been in tough and difficult times, but now we know why we came through it. You brought us through because of what you could do and build in this church. We thank you, Lord, and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Rise and thunders roar.
I would like to say one thing about how excited I am to be part of this church, and the faith that I see here is about once a month we see the giving. And I don't know if you look closely at that, but man, it is exciting, the faith we are showing by giving, especially in tougher times for some people. And so I that just excites me. So I'm going to pray for the offering, and then we'll be dismissed. Remember, you can give physically. If you've got it here, there's some boxes in the back. You can give online. Go to the church website or the app, and you can get directions there if you haven't done so already. So let me pray. Thank you, Lord, for everything you give us. And in this case, we thank you for the material blessings so we can do your work. Thank you for the generosity of this church family who are showing the love for their fellow believers in so many ways here and around the world. And I thank you, Lord, that we are going to commit to love each other as you loved us, so that when we walk out these doors, people will know we are your disciples. Thank you, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great Sunday.